Welcome back to ITFreeTraining's course on Active Directory. This is the first of several videos on group policy. The videos can be watched with the free Active Directory course or by themselves. The choice is up to you. After watching this video, you will have a better understanding on why there is a need for group policy and also the basic mechanics of how group policy works. To start with, what is group policy? Group policy is a Microsoft technology that allows centralized control of user and computer settings. It also provides control over applications, including the installation and removal of these applications when they are no longer required. Using group policy, you can control the user experience from a centralized location by customizing the look and feel of the desktop and configuring other settings on the computer. There are literally thousands of group policy settings that can be configured, allowing you to control almost every aspect of the user experience. To understand why group policy is required, consider what it was like before group policy. In a lot of cases, programs and system settings were stored in a text file like an any file. Editing this file was a little tricky, as to change one setting would mean rewriting the whole file, making the process very complicated. In those days, changes were often made by a script that was run when the user logged in and thus was referred to as a login script. To make the process easier, Microsoft introduced the registry. The registry provided a centralized store containing settings for the operating system and applications on the system. It was an expandable system that allowed for a single value to be changed at any time. The registry made configuring options a lot easier than ever before, but one problem still remained. When a change is made to the registry, the change was permanent. This is sometimes referred to as tattooing the registry. Without the ability to roll back a change, if the user were to change jobs tomorrow, this may require a different login script to be used. The new login script would not only have to make sure all settings required were made, but there needed to be an assurance that any settings made from another login script were also reversed or written over as required. With group policy, settings can be applied directly to that user and rolled back later. If, for example, a user's job title were to change, the group policy or policies assigned to that user could also change. Once this occurs, group policy is able to reverse any previous configuration made for that user. This means that the administrator only needs to worry about configuring the required settings. They do not need to worry about removing settings that were applied using previous group policy. Now that you understand the need for group policy, let's have a look at how the mechanics of group policy work. Understanding how group policy works will help you deploy and troubleshoot group policy better in your organization. Despite the fact that group policy can be used for centralized control of computers in your organization, it may surprise you to hear that it is, in fact, client-driven. Group policy works like this. The group policy settings are first created and configured and then stored in Active Directory. Once the group policy is created, it can be downloaded by the client operating system. This is why I say group policy is client-driven, as it is up to the client to download the group policy from a domain controller. This is why non-Microsoft clients can be added to the domain that do not support group policy. They simply choose not to download group policy. A system like this is called a pull system, since the client requests the information rather than the server pushing the data out to the clients. Once the client receives the group policy from the domain controller, it is up to the client to apply it to the operating system. This is done by software on the client called client-side extensions. For example, there are client-side extensions that are responsible for creating shortcuts and other extensions for installing applications. To see which client extensions are installed, I will open RegEdit from the Start menu and then navigate down through to the registry to the following location. You are not required to know this for the exam, but understanding how it works will improve your overall understanding of group policy. As shown here, all group policy client extensions have their own folder. If I select one of the folders, you can see the name of the group policy client extensions inside the folder. In this case, this extension will deploy printer connections to the client. If you want to ensure a user has certain printers on their computer, create a group policy with those printers in it. When the group policy is deployed, this group policy client extension will ensure these printers are created on the local computer and are available to the user. If I select another extension, you can see this extension is responsible for configuration of the network options on the computer. In later videos, you will see that certain group policy settings are supported by different operating systems. This is the reason why certain group policy extensions are available on different versions of Windows and are able to process certain settings. It is also possible to add additional client-side extensions if they are available. Group policy looks complex at first, but once you understand how it is broken down into sections which allow each part to be processed by different systems, it makes a lot more sense. To show you the different sections of group policy, I will now take a look at an example of a group policy. You can see that this group policy is divided into two parts, which are sometimes referred to as nodes. At the top is computer configuration. Any settings that are configured in this section are applied to the computer as a whole, affecting all users that use that computer. The user configuration settings shown at the bottom contain the same structure as computer configuration. If I go to computer configuration, the first folder down is policies. This is where the traditional group policy settings live. I say traditional because before Windows Server 2008, the policies folder did not exist. All the settings found under policies were essentially all the settings you would find in group policy. Under this is the preferences folder. Preferences were a late addition to Windows Server 2008 and added just before it was released to manufacture. Preferences was originally a third-party product called Policy Maker that was purchased by Microsoft. There is a big fundamental difference between policies and preferences. Any settings applied under policies, the user is forced to have. They do not have a choice. Any settings applied under preferences, the user has a choice if they want the setting or not. Under policies, the first folder is software settings. If you decide to use group policy to deploy and manage software, this is where the group policy software settings would be configured. The next folder down is Windows settings. Any settings under Windows settings generally have an effect on the computer as a whole. So you will not find settings in here for specific things like which shortcuts appear on the start menu. For example, you can see that startup and shutdown scripts can be configured in here. If I were to look at Windows settings under user configuration, these would be login and logoff scripts. The settings under security settings affect the security-related items on the computer. For example, the settings in here affect how certificates on the computer are used and what rights users will have. The next section is administrative templates. This contains the bulk of the group policy settings. You can see there are a lot of sections under here, for example, for the control panel and network. Administrative templates is a strange name, but later in the course, I will show you how to add additional templates and store the templates in a central store. This has been a short tour of group policy. To summarize what we have looked at, group policy is configured in Active Directory, making it centrally administered. Even though it can be used to configure all the computers in your domain, it is essentially a client-driven technology. Once the client downloads the group policy, these are applied to the operating system using client-side extensions. Which operating system you have will determine which client-side extensions are available on that system. In some cases, additional client-side extensions can be added to the operating system. In most cases, you will be limited to the ones that come with that operating system. Lastly, group policy is divided into sections. The most notable of these is the user and computer sections. At first, it may look like a lot of settings, but once you start using group policy, you will start to see that the settings are quite well organized. This video is only the first video of the group policy videos which are part of the Active Directory course. I hope you've enjoyed this video and continue to watch the rest of the videos as they are released. See you next time.